second annual Dina Win Lecture Series. For those of you who don't know me, I'm Leslie Kaufman, I'm president of Philadelphia Sculptors. And for those of you who don't know Philadelphia Sculptors, we are a nonprofit organization of sculptors, and we are interested in promoting the visibility of sculpture and expanding opportunities for artists. And what you're here tonight for is the second annual Dina Win Lecture Series. Dina Win unfortunately passed away in 2014, but she left a legacy behind her. So we decided that we would create a lecture series in her honor. We are fortunate enough to have John Win here, and John will now say a few words about the Dina Win legacy.
I just want to say that last year was a very progressive talk about sustainability and nature and sculpture, and it kind of pushed us in a new direction. This year is more personal for my mom. She loved your work. I was looking at your website last night, and it was in 1981, Whitney Biennial, that we first all discovered it together as a family. And she, my dad, my brother, and I, we followed it ever since. So this is a really personal connection, and I know that she, in some way, would be thrilled to know that you were speaking here today. And on behalf of my family, I welcome you, and welcome all of you, and thank you very much.
Thank you, John. Okay, I'm going to just say a few words about Judy. I mean, probably most of you are here already know everything there is to know about her, but she is, in my mind anyway, an icon. And when you think of installation art, you think of Judy Pfaff. She, I think, has inspired many, many artists, and maybe some of the people in this room. Clearly, she inspired Dina. And those of us who have followed her career have been very excited whenever we've had the opportunity to see any of her work. Many of you probably have been to the Convention Center and seen her major piece, probably the only permanent piece that she's ever done there. If you have not been there, you should go. But of course, Judy is really well known for her installations, which tend to be more temporary in nature. How many of you got to see her show at the Gardens last year? Okay, if you didn't, you really missed something special. But she is prolific. I have never seen anybody who is so busy because she's putting up shows over every place. So just to mention a few of the awards that Judy has received would be the MacArthur Fellowship, Guggenheim Fellowship, a few NAA grants. She's had like 22 solo shows, 35 group shows, and you know, she doesn't stop. But you can read the rest of it in the program because, you know, we could go on and on and bore each other, which we want to. So now it is my pleasure to introduce Judy Pfaff, and she will now speak to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Lisa. Thank you, Leslie. Thank you, John. That's so cool. I have a funny relationship with Philadelphia, a good one. I taught at Tyler School of Art from 73, I think, 74. I did a piece at the Convention Center. I worked with Kippy Stroud. Can you hear me?
Lower it.
John did that. And with the fabric workshop, I also, and I hadn't realized it until I walked into this museum, this beautiful museum, I did a show here in 91, which I have no images of. But anyway, and thank you for coming out on this blustery day when Trump is now our nominee. Republican nominee in the city of brotherly love. So I will begin. Good. Yes. The bad news is I don't throw things away. So the slides, there are a lot of them. The good news is I'm pretty fast. So what you're looking at is my studio in New York City in 1973. I had 13 puppies. My lovely little doggy ran away one day and came a few months later with puppies. So they rearranged these pieces that I was doing. I also had a full-time job and I was teaching at Queens College. But I graduated from Yale in painting. So my teacher, Al Held, who died a few years ago, actually 10 years ago, was horrified that I was doing this stuff. And I think no one knew what I was doing, and I don't even know if I can explain it. I just needed to touch a lot of surfaces. And I was living quite near Canal Street, so there was lots of places to get cheap materials. So I just tried to figure out like how strong a line was, or how you read a shape on the floor as opposed to being vertical. Anyway, I will go through these a lot. So there's a few years of just experimenting. This is the kind of activity that I was doing. You have to understand, none of this stuff was shown, so it's not like there was any interest. But I do have a little story about the kind of aluminum foil stuff you see on the left. Is that left? Yes. My studio was in Tribeca, and it used to be Richard Serra's studio. So I thought he would get sick if I used a lot of aluminum foil. So there is a mischievous part of doing that. Plus, it was not being able to afford lead or steel. I think it was a great, great kind of exorcism of the space. But anyway, what I liked about that material is I could make like organic shapes, aluminum foil pots and pans, some of these more heavier images. The foil, they started with big spheres of aluminum foil and pounded down. And so when you pick them up, they were like Joe Palooka dolls. The weight was off in them. So they kind of had this funny animated aspect to them. Also, the Big Apple Circus was in town, and they were on the beach downtown. When the Big Apple Circus was one tent, one clown, one, you know, and they were all kids from the Bronx or something. So it was pretty funky. So, and Philippe Petit lived down there too. So he loved these shapes because if he juggled them, they sort of had their own way, yeah? At this point, I'm now teaching at CalArts in the 70s, 76, I think it was. CalArts was Walt Disney's school. So the first thing I did is I tried to sort of honor like the Steamboat Willie. So these kind of shapes I thought looked kind of like a black and white, you know, cartoon. And everything, because it's in the high desert, and if you open a door, everything rolled around. So it had a kind of animation to it. This was, I'm again teaching at CalArts, and I decided to take this sculpture thing seriously. There was a shop there called the Wonder Shop, and so I learned to put wood together, some, and TIGging and MIGging and, you know, cement. And so this was a show of these figures, and every one of them had a name and an identity and was made of something which I thought related quite like that to them. You can't see it, but all the way back, there's a little green shape you can begin to see. That was from Mike Kelly. He was my student, and it was Kelly Green. So there was those kinds of associations going on. That fellow walking into the wall was Richard Archfager. He thought it was a portrait of me dealing with him rather than him. And he was very smart, so that was probably true. And it was made out of rock maple, because it's, I don't know if you know him, he's great. Anyway, so what I also have to tell you is all of these things were, in my mind, were just one piece. So this was like this inhabited room of my friends and my relationships. You have to understand, at Yale, you walk in, this is in 1973, the painters were on one side, the sculptors were on another side, the figure painters were on one side, sorry, the figure painters were on one side and the abstract painters were on the other, doing this thing which was obviously figurative, no matter how minimal, freaked me out. I just thought, oh, I can hear Al now. He's just yelling at me. Not only did I do this fuzzy stuff, and this loose stuff, but now I was doing stick figures, you know. So anyway, for me, it was a way of identifying all my relationships. I think at certain ages, you do certain things. This is, I'm 30, some of my relationships were falling apart. So it gave me a way to identify them and to kind of have them around, I guess. So at this point, I don't know if you can tell, I just got a grant for $10,000 and I spent it on plastic. So this was an NEA grant. This space is about 100 feet long, 50 feet wide, 30 feet tall. It's in the Neuberger Museum, and it was put together by Irving Sandler, who was a very good friend, and he ran Artist Space. So this show, along with 10, I think, other artists, including Laurie Anderson and, Ree Morton, Thomas Lanigan Schmidt, some wonderful artists. It was a survey because we'd all shown at Artist Space 6 years before. So this was, I was given this room, and the interesting thing is, and it's something I actually never quite knew until a little bit later, there was no director. So the museum was directorless. So therefore, I'm working in the middle of the night, I'm doing things by myself, I'm climbing ladders and putting in lights, and this is not what you do in museums, by the way. So anyway, for me, what I liked about it was called Reinventing the Wheel, is this whole space was held together by this thinnest amount of material, really. There's not much mass. And it kind of had a sparkly thing. I thought it looked like video or television when you walked around. Everything was kind of flickering. Now, you have to understand, I know what this thing really looked like, and you're just looking at an image, so I have no idea what you think it is. This was a kind of my introduction to the real art world. I showed with a gallery named Holly Solomon, who, you know, kind of imagined herself to be like Marilyn Monroe. She always wanted to be an actress. She was an actress. She had bleached blonde hair. She was 4'9". I didn't know she was 4'9". I thought she was like gigantic. She was so enthusiastic. That's like an understatement for like art and poets and, you know, kids. And she just wanted it all. She had great taste, I think. She was the first person to ever show Polka, Schnabel, Mapplethorpe, Gordon Mata Clark, Laurie Anderson. And she was known for showing a lot of the, they were called the decorative P&D, pattern decoration. So anyway, she saw that show at the Neuberger and wanted me in the gallery, and so she just saw this stuff and just couldn't believe that this is what I was doing. She just thought it was like hippie art. And then she got this idea. She said, if I could sell this, I will be a great dealer. So I think that was like her inspiration to be enthusiastic. Because like I said, initially she was, you know, nonplussed, that's for sure. This was made on my rooftop in Greenpoint in Brooklyn, and I had gone to Mexico, to Merida, to the Yucatan, and I was, I don't know, hearing stuff about what, there was a little bit of writing, not much, but it was all sort of horrible, like that I'm, what, you know, explosion in a glitter factory, it was all sort of this stuff. And I thought, no, there are ideas here. Transparency. I wanted it to have a narrative. These were forbidden words at the time. You have to understand that the art world, if you were smart and if you were a New Yorker, you did conceptual pieces and minimalism, which is still reigns king. So it's not like that's really changed. But I think because I was a painter that there were other options, meaning color and a liveliness and a kind of commodification or a commercialization, something, those words, I forget which ones I'm supposed to use. But anyway, it was an experience, and it was called Deep Water. So in a way, you can't tell, but it's about 80 feet long, and as you walked in, I thought it did look like you were going down instead of across. It felt that way, as the way I measure things for this show. And the installation part of what I do was never a big idea of mine. It was because things look really shitty when they got out of my studio. And so I think I just recreated a new space for them to have some life pumped back into it. So the gallery sort of became a kind of studio. This was the rest of these are going to be of a certain kind. That's that kind of, this was called Kabuki. It was in Hirshhorn. There was the Hirshhorn and the Whitney Museum in 81. They came quite close together. I have a little story about this one. I was bringing down all this material, and it blew off in a snowstorm off the back of my truck and trailer somewhere between New York and DC. A lot of it was lost, so I had to change my mind absolutely about what I did. And that evening, in despair, I saw a Kurosawa movie, Kagamusha, and I thought, ooh, and I saw my space and it looked very kabuki. So this, I think, has this kind of funny pageantry of that film. I'm the only one who thinks that, by the way. This was in the Whitney Museum. The piece was called Dragon. And again, the Whitney is a union shop. The good news is I'm there so late that I get to know all these guys, and they were guys. So they would say at the end, since you're not finished and you don't know what you want us to do, we're gonna leave. And we won't tell anybody if you're up on the ladder and scaffolding and putting in your own lights. And it's like, yes. So you just kind of wear them down, I think. That was the common practice at the time. I don't know if I could get away with that now, because museums have become so difficult, I think, anyway. This is the same show. It was called Dragon because you bifurcated it, and one side looked... I thought, like very English, like St. George and a Dragon, which is a kind of my grandmother used to tell stories, and things like those kinds of images, I don't know, stayed with me. So one side had one sort of kind of slashing sort of thing, and the other had sort of a fire thing going. This is, I don't know, maybe next year. It was called Rorschach, and what I can see is the mood is changing. This was, I thought, extremely moody. It looked like Ozenfant to me when I got finished. It was like, it was more stoic and odd, and not metaphysical, but something odd. Anyway, I have a funny story about this. This is in the University of Massachusetts in Amherst, and I don't read at all, anything. So if you ever email me, you'll hardly ever get an answer except yes and or no. But I thought Amherst was in Vermont. So I had this great feeling about meeting woodsmen. I don't know if you've been to Amherst. There are no woodsmen in Amherst. It is all professors, you know. And so I didn't chop down any trees. I got the wood from the lumber yard, and it was like 20 by 20 by 20 feet long, quite a big kind of timber. And by the time I got through with it, it was in, shards. And the fellow outside was Richard Nonus, who's a minimalist. And he actually had ordered the exact same dimensional wood. Both pieces got delivered, and he's saying, that's mine, and I'm saying, that's mine. We were both right. But at the end, his was still it, and mine was this, all this stuff. Now, the thing about this show that I liked is when you walked by, there were these cones in it, and when you walked by, it picked up your breathing, or if you were talking to somebody, it amplified, it did something to the sound in the room, which was not intentional, but I really, really liked that thing that happened. So and really what I'm saying is, like, no matter why I'm doing these things and what I think, this is actually called boa, as in I'm being eaten by a boa constrictor, because it was 8 feet high. You could touch the ceiling. 10 feet wide and 80 feet long. So it was really, and when I first got the dimensions of the space, I said, great, piece of cake. I couldn't get out of there. It was like building a ship in a bottle, you know. It was really, like, not a fun experience, claustrophobic to say the least. Anyway, that's my story. This is, you can see these cones sort of got to be the image of this show. This was at the Venice Biennale in, I don't actually know what year, 80s, early 80s. And it was called Either War. And, you know, you say things like the Venice Biennale, and that just sounds so great. And it is, you're in Italy, and you're in Venice, that's great. But this show got put together a few weeks because the curator died. And the new curator came to New York and was wined and dined by every gallery dealer in the world, in the United States anyway. And so Holly said, take Judy, you know, it's like, so it wasn't like, it was peculiar because you thought you were chosen, and you were just like Holly's favorite at that moment. And when I got there, there's no place to stay. You're in a high tourist season. So I was in a, you know, walking around trying to find a place to stay. It was on the Giudecca, which is a great place. And there were strikes, as you know, so you couldn't get from one place to the other because all the taxis and evaporators were all down. Anyway, so while I was there, there was no electricity in this place. So I smashed those holes in the, you see there are two holes? Yeah, I put those in because I needed some light. And anyway, every show has a story. The stories are less interesting now because they don't let you do things like smash holes in walls. That's me working. This is in Germany. I have to digress one more time. I'll go faster sooner than later. This was in Germany. The show was called Westkunst, which means Western art. It was a survey show from 1935 to 1981, I guess. There were no women in this show, in the historical part of the show. That's 1935 to the 80s, right? So, and they reconstructed like Oldenburg's store days, Joseph Beuys's first show, Richard Serra's lead pieces, Kurt Schwitter's. It was international, it was a huge, huge space. There was a corridor of young people, and there were two women in that place. There were hundreds of artists in this show, and I never got it before. Like, I was the only woman in my class at Yale. I got teaching jobs because no school had women teachers. And the art world, there were no women in its history. I don't know if you know Janssen's or Gardner's history of art. That went from, let's see, the cave paintings to whenever it was done. There was not a woman in there. Now, why that didn't seem odd to anybody, or even to me, I don't know, but anyway. This was in Albright Knox. The room was called the Clifford Still Room. There was a plaque that said the Clifford. So that's what's geared the color and the kind of shapes in this. And it was called Rock, Paper, Scissors. This was going to be my very last installation. This is in that same show that was in Holly Solomon. And it was about 5 years or so later. And again, this is 60 feet of space, sorry. It was everything I knew, and that was it. I was making everybody nuts around me. I had no money, I was in debt, I was working, tired, pissing everybody off. So it was like, okay, stay with me one more time. I won't do this anymore. And then I did it again. And this is in Japan. And the great news about this was there was money. They had money. I was there for a few months. I got a studio there. They bought me I didn't know how much money. No one talks about money. So I just bought things. I would go around and I would take 20 bamboo things or 20 grids for pouring cement. That was the only number I knew. And then you had to actually know how to say 20 flat things or 20 heavy things or something. But anyway, so that's, and I built this floor, and this was the piece. This space is the equivalent of the ground floor of the Guggenheim. So that's the kind of arena it is. And this was my homage to Japan, because I think every once in a while that I'm Japanese, or I should be, or I want to be, or now I think should be Indian. I change. I'm very fickle about my incarnations. So anyway, the whole floor was cut from wood, so it was a big wood cut, and there was architectural references from country architecture, some ikebana, and there was also some signage in here, and the things said things like, this kanji is like from signs from restaurants. It would say tree or river or flat or mountain. And then when I found all these things, it dawned on me that everybody who I was working with, their names were east of the river Kawanishi, or so they were in it too, sort of signed in. And you know that thing, Lost in Translation, you know the movie? That movie was shot in this place called the Akasaka Prince, which is this fabulous place. The fellow who was building this compound, it was called the Spiral Building, and Maki was the architect. He thought I was a lucky charm because that studio that he rented for me was, he was going to build apartments and places for people to live, apartments. And he couldn't because the zoning was wrong. By the time I left, something happened and the zoning was changed. He made billions of dollars. So after this show, set me up in the Akasaka Prince and sent presents every day. So I was like, oh my God. So this is one of the good stories I have. This Holly Solomon moved uptown, and these were I had to make things that kind of would be things, like objects, like I'm supposed to do. This show is called Apples and Oranges. And they're all woks, those shapes. There was a wok company going out of business when I came back from Japan. It was on 13th Street, and I'm driving by, and it literally said, like, sale woks. They made all the woks for Chinatown, and I thought, well, this is good. And as I'm leaving, filling up this truck with hundreds of steel and aluminum woks, he says to me, do you know the guy who lives next door? He's an artist too. I said, I don't know, it could be. It was Frank Stella. And I said, okay. Did Frank buy any woks? He didn't. He said, I don't know why. I would have thought he would have liked them. And I was like, yes. Anyway, so. I thought that most sculpture was not generous, and I wanted it to feel kind of more edible or delicious or market-like, or I don't know. Anyway, this is my like American, like who is that? Stuart Davis thing, something. And this was in John Weber Gallery, and across from this piece, Saul LeWitt, who is a friend, was a friend, had a piece. He painted the wall black and had these beautiful drawings of circles. And I've said this so many times, but it's like, it just looked like we both had the same homework, and we resolved it. We were like yin and yang, you know. It was a wonderful relationship. This was at the Whitney Biennial in 87. That's the side of it. So I think you can tell there's a kind of lot more structuring going on. And like an exoskeleton. I don't think things were as opaque and sort of flat in that way. This is in my studio upstate now, but these are pieces from then. This is the work I was doing right before I went to Pilchuck, which is a glass blowing place. I love glass blowers. Always generous and good. And all the color left for a while. And I thought about just air and their blowing and everything I make in glass breaks. So it's not a good medium for me, but the place and the spirit of working there was good for me. This is my continuing attempt. This lasted for about 3 years, trying to make things. There's some glass in this one. I think if it wasn't this piece, it would be pieces like this, which was in my show here, 91, I think, with Kippy Stroud. And I didn't, she let me get away with woven wire instead of, you know, weaving. I mean, she didn't really care what you did. I was like, oh my God, how am I gonna do this? I don't make fabrics. My design skills suck. But my grandmother was a seamstress, so I have great affinity for things which are handmade. So there was a wonderful woman who helped me, named Pat, who I think still lives in Philadelphia. And she sat in the backyard and wove this stuff through these structures. So these were the pieces which were in the show here, that was in this museum. This is my friend Ursula von Riddingsvard and I working together in our only collaborative, but we're still very, very good friends. It was called Zygmunt. And because I worked with Ursula, and Ursula works exclusively with cedar, I got kind of smitten with that wood, but she uses 4x4s or 2x4s of cedar. And I would call her from Seattle saying, this is Cedar Central, you know, like you can get cedar shakes, you can get, you know, stumps, she was horrified. So anyway, she kind of taught me about, you know, wood and the weight of things, and things got a little earthier. This was called Flusso e Reflusso, Ebb and Flow, in a Max Protech gallery, sorry. That's the back of it. So you can see there is actually a lot of detail. It's a show at that was called the Elvium in Madison, Wisconsin, where I make a lot of prints and drawings. So it was a kind of a survey. This is the rooftop of the Denver Art Museum. This is a place called Exit Art. I don't know if any of you remember that place. I think it was the best curated and radical showing space. Jeanette Ingberman and Papacolo put it together. This was in a show that was it was called Garden of Sculptural Delights, sort of after Bosch. So I thought this imagery should get more liquid and icky. So there's a lot of fiberglass resin in this, which makes me stick still, but anyway. So this is the kind of work that I was doing with a lot of resins and glass, actually. And a lot of these things have water filled in them, so if you lift it up, the whole thing swings around or moves. It's my studio in Brooklyn. You can see the glass there and the fiberglass. I've taught everywhere, but I ran the department at Bard College. I still, up until a year ago or so, I was still there. And you have to understand, not only don't I do emails, I don't do meetings. And I ran the place for 22 years, and we did good. Now it's a little more legit, but this is my studio. It's right on the river, on the Hudson. And that's the way I work. There's like, if I make one, I make 20, you know. The young lady down there is Laura Gale. She has now two children. This is at Brandeis. The great Carl Belts was the fellow there. It was called Elephant. I'd just done the Philadelphia piece here, and I was supposed to do this show, and there was no time, and I didn't know what to do, and I was brought a lot of the equipment up and some tools. I had no image. It's a beautiful gallery, and I'm sitting in a truck, and it's a blizzard. It's near, it's in Waltham, Mass, I think. And I'm in the parking lot. It's midnight. I'm in tears. I don't know what to do. I hate to tell Carl that I've blown it. And this tree falls down in front of me, literally. And I thought, I got this. So I brought that tree in. It was a birch. And you can't tell, but down below there's a reflecting pool that hadn't been open for 20 years. So they brought me wonderful, you know, water hyacinth and water lilies. And so this stuff, it was mostly fiberglass, which I could make very fast and spill down into it. But anyway, this is in Columbus, Ohio. I used to teach at Columbus, Ohio in 74. All I remember is being freezing, and all my students were Woody Hayes football team guys, which were gigantic, and I was teaching a class on watercolor to these giant men. So I decided we would do a class on colored water. So I had them mix up dyes and pour it on the snow, and that's how they got their grade from me. So when I got back there to do it, I just thought, all I can think, and it was again winter. Ohio winters are worse than, I don't know, the Yukon winters, or, you know, because it's miserable. Anyway, so I managed to take out the whole ceiling, well, part of the ceiling, and I managed to lower the temperature of the entire museum because the HVAC system went a little whack. So anyway, I liked this show though. It was so white. And I think kind of sparkly. It's a lot of fiberglass resin pouring through the ceiling. This was at Andre Emmerich. I don't know if you know who that gallery was. Who he was. Very elegant man. I think he was from Holland or Belgium. And he showed all of the lyrical abstractionists. And I cut holes in his wall and poured all this plaster there. He closed the gallery about 3 months later. I still think that this was part of the reason. I think he just had it at this point. But anyway, he was a good friend, and he let me do whatever I needed to do. Like, I don't know if you knew that gallery, but he never opened the curtains. There were these long kind of 70s shades. Because he said, you know, real life is so much more interesting than artwork that everybody would just go to the window. This is on Fifth Avenue. And I thought, yeah, that's true. But so we opened all the windows, and I thought it helped a lot, the space that, you know, I don't know, don't you get crazy in galleries? There's no windows, there's no light, there's just these strange people sitting at desks who won't look at you, and, you know. And if, I don't know, I think the whole experience of going to a gallery is like off-putting, to say the least. Except these galleries here are very beautiful. So I was pleased. You have Alison Schutz? Is that her name? Alison Schutz? This is at in Brazil. And What I realized looking at the plans of previous biennales in Sao Paulo, that everyone had closed up these windows because the space Oscar Niemeyer had made it for machines. It was a kind of a space to show, you know, front end loaders and things. And no one wants, you can't show paintings on a window. So everyone has always walled it up. So I thought that inside outside thing was what to do. So I kept it open and it went 120 feet long. And that park outside is like, it's called the Ibirapuera, which is quite like what Central Park is to Sao Paulo, but more so, like 1,000 times. There was like kids and people getting married and hanging out. It was fabulous. I mean, it's Brazil. So the structure of it was based on these two Catholic churches, which were built sort of on top of one another. So it was actually called Crown of Thorns, but it's called Coroa de Espinhos. I'm not saying it right. But it's that stuff that's around. Rich Brazilians have that as the equivalent of barbed wire. It's this really nasty plant. And so I built the staircase, which you could never do. And at opening night, there must have been 20 people on that. And it's like, oh my God, I don't know if it's going to hold. It did. It was good. Oh, this is your piece here. I don't do public art. When this commission came about, they said, the people who were kind of overseeing the selection, there were some mandates like, don't touch the ceiling, don't do this. And I thought, I don't know, the ceiling's the only beautiful thing there. So I made this really quite nice model and thought, great, they gave me $5,000 to make the model. I won't get this thing, perfect. And then I got it. And it's like, and so myself and 4 undergraduates from Columbia University who were American Studies majors built this thing because there was no budget to hire a Lippincott or a place that fabricates. And I'll tell you, this is why I won't do it again. But I learned a lot, but it took, you know, you had to pay. Since there was a model, they thought that that's what I was going to do. Oh my God, and I had to find a place to build it. So anyway, stories. This was my favorite show. This was up at Dartmouth. And I was not going to do an installation. I was just going to show drawings. But then I saw the space, and it was a shape of a fish. And I'm thinking, you're never going to get a chance to do that again. So there were all these sweet molds that I did. And I think of this as like Madame Blavatsky or something. There was something very odd and lunar and weirdy. Sort of, I had worked for Albers when I was at Yale. And so that all that color theory stuff was like, I do know it. And then I just thought, but I don't like it. So I wanted to do something which was odder than that, and had that's made me feel strange, and it just had a weirdness in it. This is right after 9/11, and this piece was done in Savannah, Georgia. It was supposed to open in September, and I lived 4 blocks away from the World Trade Center. And I was, I couldn't do anything. I just was, you know, there was, you couldn't get downtown. There was no electricity for a while and no place to, you know, it was devastated. And so I changed the show to November. And then I did this whole thing, you can't tell, but it was about reconstruction. So there was, I don't know, because it's sort of this Civil War city and it wasn't burned. But I took molds off of all of the details of the old architecture there. This is at that place called the Elvium. It's a University of Madison, University of Wisconsin in Madison. And it's a very brutal kind of building. It's all concrete and lots of staircases and lots of... So I thought, give them more. The bottom is a what do they call it? A pilgrimage sort of maze. And what you can't tell are those, there are spires, and they're held in place by these lead balls. And if the lead moves, if someone happens to just move the wire, the whole structure swayed. It was sort of, I was thinking about Gaudí and that beautiful, beautiful model he did for the La Sagrada Familia. So I thought, oh yeah, I got this 70-foot ceiling and I just have to, anyway. So for some reason, there's a lot of churchy images in my work, and I don't know why, because I'm about the least religious person I know. But also, I thought this space felt like a place where you, in the middle of winter in Madison, I am afraid of cold. Oh my God, I can't stand, like wet, cold. I'm English, forget about it. This is supposed to be May in Philadelphia. So anyway, so there were gardens. I put lots of gardens all over the place there. So if you did come in out of the cold, you would be more happy. This is a show in Japan of drawings, Tokyo. These are the prints I do in Madison. They're my, it's the Panchenkos. It's Paula Panchenko who runs Tandem Press and her husband who runs the museum. And they are just, these were my first prints, and I remember telling them that nothing ever sells, so just make an edition of 3 or 5 or something. She, thank goodness, did not listen to me, because this is the first thing I ever really sold. It was like, and the money just kept coming in. There's something about being a printmaker. Young people, learn to make prints. And so this is my studio, and when I'm making bigger prints, I bring everything home and work on it, because I am not good with other people. This was a show in my new gallery, and it was a kind of survey of architectural motifs. So there are kind of Islamic grids and things from the pagan plain and Buddhist temples and post and beam structures and the images from my, I have a Victorian house, so there was lots of images from there. I think you can see a mandala in the red there. So the show had four rooms, so each room had a kind of an overlap of architectural motifs. This is a stage set I did at the Frank Gehry. Frank Gehry did a fantastic, well, the outside is fantastic, inside is just like normal, but building on the Bard campus, so it was an opera set called Regina. It's based on the book The Little Foxes. I only knew the movie, but there actually was an opera by Blitzstein. That's my dog, Willie. At this moment, my mom died. Al Hell died. Elizabeth Murray followed a little bit later than that. It just felt like everyone I knew or cared for died at the same time. And I just didn't know what to do. I had this show to do. And I thought, well, I'll just do something about light and dark and have it be, have that. And since I'm sort of known for color, that was when I told the gallery. And also the black is soot, it's not paint, it's soot. You know, they have Hans Hoffman in the gallery and, you know, Ken Nolan's and Al Held's and, and it went through the whole vent system in the gallery. Soot. I think when I left there, I think they were so happy. So this is the image. When you walked off the elevator, that's what you saw. And the light just kept flooding through as the, because it was facing west. This is me in the studio. This is the piece in a beautiful gallery called Rice Gallery in Houston, Texas. They do fantastic work. She only invites artists and furniture makers and designers and graffiti guys and musicians to do site-specific installations. These are drawings. I'm going to start going faster now. I told someone, sometimes I think I'm asleep, like there's this kind of a... Anyway, I will, that's Willie again. These drawings were made from the drops making the prints. Because when you do prints, as you know, they're cutting out a shape, and it'd be like, save me what was left. So for a couple years, I had all this beautiful material. I mean, obviously, I changed it, but and made these drawings. They're about 8 feet square. And then I found this new stuff. It's called, it's called Void Fill, V-O-I-D, Fill. It's a packing material. And I found the guy in Bogalusa, Louisiana, who made the machines to glue the craft paper together in this honeycomb pattern. And he's the only one who has the patent for this. And so you cannot buy the raw material. You have to get it from Uline and pay $1 billion for it because it has laminated on top and bottom, so it's used in packing. But he gave me the material because I stayed on the phone and told him I was a teacher and I needed it for my students. And he sent all this stuff to me for free. And then I sent him a book of my stuff, and I apologize that I didn't lie because I am a teacher, but it was for me, not for them. Anyway, he forgave me. You can't tell, but that's that stuff. And then I discovered melting plastic from Target. So most of these things are made from packing boxes, storage boxes from Lowe's. And then I discovered light bulbs. So every one of these things has its own light that goes with it. And I've never been more happy. Studio drawings, and that's how they get installed. It's now the 2000s. We're getting there, so just hang on. I was in Laramie, Wyoming for a year. I was teaching at the University of Wyoming. Do you know how many universities there are in Wyoming? One four-year university in Wyoming. One city got the mining rights, the mines. One city got to be the capital, and one city, Laramie, got to have the university. There are 500,000 people in the state. There are 3 or 4 million in Brooklyn. So think about that. It's incredible. So anyway, everything had, I think, this kind of Western feeling in it. Brown and kind of dried out. I don't go to Laramie in the winter. Well, one, you can't get there from here, but you know, I'd be landing in Denver and you'd be waiting 2 days till they cleared Route 70. This was at a show a few years ago at and it was that Brown show, the Laramie kind of infiltrated show, was downstairs, and this was upstairs. This is at Loretta Howard's gallery. That piece was called Blue Note. It was for Al Held, and all of these other little clusters were for her artists. One was for Bridget Riley, one was for Helen Frankenthaler, one was for whoever. And this was in the back room. So they were kind of three shows. This was at York College. And the reason I love this place is because it had an octagon. And actually, even the other place is a shape. You can't tell because I sort of obliterated that. But so you walk in. This was wonderful place. If you ever get a chance to go kind of on vacation, you have kids or something, or just want to see great glass, is the Wheaton Arts in Millville?
Yes,
in New Jersey. I always thought it was in Pennsylvania, so I keep thinking I'm always in Pennsylvania, but I'm not. I'm sometimes in New Jersey. This room is like a bordello. You know, it's got red flocked wallpaper, and can you tell it looks like a bordello? So when I had this chandelier, I've always had it, and I had it powder coated red, and I told the glass blowers, and this is not my, to make me really phallic-y things, which horrified me that I even said that, and more horrifying that they actually made that, and guys know how to do this stuff. And I don't know, it was so fun because it was sort of in such bad taste. And I don't mean to do bad taste. And it had in the middle of the room this beautiful chandelier that is lead crystal and is amazing. So there were lots of riffs off of that. This was getting ready for the Barnes show. Don't do an installation at the Barnes. They won't know what to do with you. So this is sort of, these grids you see are actually based on the patterns that in the galleries, that's the shapes of the paintings. They're all kind of, there's a lot of symmetry there and a lot of stuff there. So a lot of these images are botanical images, and there's actually some at the bottom, you can see there's references to the when it was at in Marion. But the show, it's funny because I was in this show with Fred Wilson and Mark Dionne, and they're very political artists, very smart and very conceptual. And I thought, oh, everyone's going to be political. I want to do something about Mrs. Barnes because she's like the forgotten person. She actually had a lot of influence. She had a lot, she had money. She was from Brooklyn. I think her family had made fine furniture. I have a feeling she had a lot to do with the organization and the ensemble. This is, you can't get information from people at the Barnes because it's sort of secret or something. Anyway, so I made a garden, an imaginary garden for Mrs. Barnes because they had sort of taken the museum away. I'm going to get in trouble when I say things. I thought it was really girly for me because it was kind of, now you have to understand everything is welded steel and poured schmutz and, you know, stuff. So it isn't physically that way, but the quality was really like lacy and, which I don't know if that's girly or not, but anyway, it was lacy. And they were, you can tell the lights are made from these old metal, like sconces and like chandelier lights. And that's the, this is a new piece I just did at Lafayette College that just got taken down, I don't know, 2 weeks ago, it could be three. What I added in this show, which for me was new, are these kind of mandalas. You walk every 10 feet or so, the color changed, and there was images within that space. And it was really referenced an enormous amount of like Tibetan art and, a lot of things. This is where I am yesterday. I've got 4 weeks to pull this thing together. and that's my new dog, and his friend. It's Mickey and Baloo. Thank you very much. Thank you. Yes.
Since most of these are temporary installations, yes. Do you recycle your materials?
Just lately, like those stumps that you saw when I said this is what I'm where I am now, they're from 20 years ago. Most of the time, no, because it's a little bit like taking a fender from a Chevy and putting it on a Ford. It's very similar, but it's not quite right, you know, it doesn't quite fit. And the scale a lot of times is wrong, because a lot of times these objects are scaled to the place. So if it has higher ceilings or it's denser, things feel differently. But the neutral objects, like the if there's a lot of grid work, like a lot of that gets turned into tables and lamps, you know, so a little bit like that, but very seldom. But more and more, because I have, I should show you pictures of the studio, but I have a very big kind of compound that had 8 buildings on it when I got it, and no water and no electricity, but these buildings. And so I can kind of keep things now where I threw everything away for about 35 years, yeah. Yes.
How are those pagoda-shaped objects made?
They're...
They made on site?
Yes, yes. And I don't do it now. I've learned a little bit. When I was teaching at Skowhegan, and there's actually an old student here from Skowhegan, I found from the WPA, there were these things called sweep molds. And Italians would, you know, if you made things for chandeliers to come down, but they also, if you turn them upside down, they look like a drop of water, you know, like ridges and stuff. So, you know, so it showed you how to design the template and the thing for that. So, but these were like 20 feet in diameter, so it was not quite that. So it's all live plaster. When I did it in Andre's place, there were 3,000 pounds of wet plaster being poured in this elegant gallery. I think he went to the Hamptons for the week. But that stuff is so beautiful. It's really a beautiful shape. Now what I've done is I can cut styrofoam and just pour the plaster over a shell. And they would also, like I said, I mean, they didn't weigh 3,000. Well, they did. They got, well, they're wet. They weighed more. So I'm a little cleverer, but yeah, I love those shapes. They're very, very beautiful, and they offset so well. I also think they're such pure form that actually I didn't have a picture of it. I'm just making one which is a dome, and I think it's going to have drawings all around it. So it'll probably look like a kind of a constellation map or something like that. It's very pretty. And it's 15 feet in diameter, which is doesn't sound big, but it feels big. So. Yes.
So the last photograph that you said was yesterday, I think?
Yes.
Can you say where that is?
Oh, yeah, yeah. There's a friend of mine, the name of, she was called Francine Hunter, now it's Francine Hunter McGibbon. She bought a barn. It wasn't an animal barn. I think it was maybe for record storage, which is 150 feet long by 50 feet wide. And it's like a kind of poor man's Dia, if you've ever been to Dia. And it's 10 miles from my studio. So of course I said, yeah, no problem. And now it's like, and plus it's been raining all week and it's been cold and miserable. My dogs are saying like, why did you bring me here, you know? But she does great stuff. She's herself has been around the art world, but she was with a group of artists like Nan Golden and like a kind of club scene. And a lot of her very good friends, very good artists have died because of AIDS and things like that. So she's really been around, and she's one of the smartest people I know in a very peculiar way. Like, maybe like all of us, but but it's called CR10, meaning County Route 10. So it's very near Bard College. It's if you know where Olana is, if you know upstate, like everybody goes antiquing in Hudson, so it's about 10 miles south of Hudson, right on that road, like between 9 and 9G. Yeah. You guys have great stamina.
Yeah, what would make this the last question?
So much of your work is site specific.
Yes.
You can take these components.
Yes.
Right in the gallery. Also, you seem to, maybe more in the last couple decades, made pieces that seem to be somewhat more discreet.
Yes.
Can you just speak briefly about how when you make things more discreet, when you're working, say,
It really depends on where I am. Like, lately I've been invited, like at the Weatherspoon, which is a gallery in the South. Is that North Carolina? They wanted to have a more historical show. At the Elvium, they wanted me to do an installation and a historical show. So I will do that. But and most of the work, which are pieces, were really from this one period from 88 to 92, I think. And now just lately, there is an answer. I'm remembering what the answer is. I had an assistant named Jamie Hamilton, who was the world's most elegant welder. And he's an artist himself, and he is a tightrope walker and a yoga guy, and he's like healthy. He could weld like upside down and get it right. Beautiful. And I realized that a lot of the architectural work I was doing was because I had, my right hand was this fabulous guy. And when he left, I thought, I can't do this anymore. I can't think that someone is gonna be there to do that, because no one could do that. So everything you see now is made of paper, means I can lift it. Even if they're big, there's components and I can lift it. And that material, which is that void fill material, it can be 50 feet long and, it can squish down into nothing. It's accordion pleated, right? So it had to do with lots of things. One, money. Two, not having the talent. Three, it's a different era. People don't work through the night anymore. And those early shows, there was just me and one person. And it would take three solid days and nights. And if you were working in a museum, museums don't give you a week to work in. You had, count it, 3 days max. And that means bringing everything in, finding your way around, finding, not pissing someone off, so yeah, the work now is because I can make it myself. I have an assistant now. I only have one real assistant who works with me, who takes on a lot of responsibility in Christian, and he answers phone calls, which I don't, and writes things and knows how to do things and gets me out of trouble. But he also organizes the crates and packing the truck. He likes to fit things, where I'd be like, let's just get another truck, and throw it all in. But yeah, I think a lot of it is like how old I am, what I think I can do, what I can lift, what my, I will do shows, if they ask me, I will do it. If they build it, they will come, but they don't come, but you do build it. And it's fun for me. Installations are great fun. Like the one in Lafayette College, it's a very fancy school. I don't know, have you been there? It's really close, isn't it?
2 hours.
Is it 2 hours? That's actually a long way away. But it's beautiful. It's on the Delaware. It has bluffs. It's remarkable architecture. It's a very fancy school. And this little gallery had a cement floor and, beams in, so it was very comfortable to work in. So sometimes it'll be like, will they let me work? Then I will work. If they won't let me work, like let's say the Barnes, which was incredibly complicated to get anything through there, And it's a, you know, the gorgeous collection, but I have difficulty with the politics of that place. I won't even go there. I'm in Philadelphia, keep it down. So, yeah, a lot of the decisions are based on logistics and, you know. Thank you very much.